Hello. Good morning. Why does that not show up? Hi, chat. How's it going? Okay, that works now. Wait, why is it? Weird. Okay. Well, hello. How's everyone doing? I'm doing well. Feeling pretty good. Decided to resume on Stroke. We're going to finish up. Well, not finish up. But we're going to continue working on how to paint up Croak really fast. Just sweet. Got to figure out what the next step is here. Probably doing the vines. And then...
Why is there a fly in the studio?
Oh, I got a thing for that.
Hi! Oh, no, no. I can see Jordan running around the studio with a fly swatter. I got it!
I know where one is.
Yes. The lime green one.
Yep.
I think there's a pink and a blue. I think Jen bought like a 3-pack at one point.
So, missed out yesterday on the final bit of stream. We painted a bunch of Croak in an hour and a half.
Not finished.
It is not finished, but we got a lot done. Kind of teaching people how to paint using transparents to approach large, complicated projects like this.
But I don't understand. It's not done.
In an hour and a half. How long have you been painting Dante?
About 30 minutes. I have about 30 or 45 minutes into Dante.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
About 30 or 45
minutes. So I have like 5 seconds into this model.
I have, no, you just said an hour and a half.
Well, if we're talking about your kind of relativity, different than mine.
That's not even a word. You're just making stuff up. You asked me, I gave an honest answer, and now you're lying to me.
I would never do that.
You are, though. Blatantly lying to me.
No, no, yeah. No, I would never do that. All right, chat. We're going to start out with some brown. we're gonna get these vines painted.
Only 3 models were purple and green, the attempted fly swatting. Exactly, right? Jess, what's going on?
Jess, hello.
And it's a wad tomato N.
Wad tomato N. Paint liquor, hello. We got the crew in town. Take some transparent brown. In our patented accidental upside down bottle. And I think we're just going to throw right on top of these vines. Hey-ya. I want to keep this right out of the pot because I want this to not be super weak. I want the intensity of color from this transparent, so I'm not thinning it down.
I think Wad is insinuating that he licks rhino butts.
That sounds right.
If I'm reading the emojis correctly, he is licking rhino butt. Eric Duck, what is going on? Thank you. Hello.
Hello. Thank you for the follow.
I had to look at that for a second. I'm like, well, Epic Duck, but it's Eric Duck. Wad says, how dare you?
Two different people.
How dare you assume I lick rhino butt? I mean, your emojis say it right there. You called out Paint Licker, who just did the rhino butt, and now you have the Zambies Brush Licker. Licking rhino butt. I might not be as hip as all the new kids, but I see what's going on here.
Hey, somebody likes us.
But hey, I see what's going on here.
Somebody likes us. Stay tuned, chat. Much painting of vines in your future. Or more specifically, in my future.
Yeah, I was gonna say.
Well, technically their future too, because they gotta watch it.
They can leave.
Well, no, they no, they can't.
You have to paint them.
They're not allowed to watch.
I mean, technically you don't have to. You could actually play a game without Lord Croak.
True. He's pretty good, though. I think he's worth keeping around. Also, he's just a really cool model. So, we're going to keep him.
It is a very, very cool model. Remember when they first announced the new Croak? I was like, okay, that's a good upgrade.
Yep.
That's a decent upgrade he got.
Because the other model was just super old, right?
Oh, super old. I don't think the other one ever got an upgrade. I think that's the first time they've redone a Croak. Just the little teeny weeny
slant
wrapped mummy.
Rock. Hello, Source. How's it going? Shard, what's up? I mean, I'm using transparent paints on the vines, so you could also use that as a shortcut. I'll probably hit him with a dry brush afterwards, though. Just a wee bit. Just a wee bit of the dry brushing. Nice, it's good, I like it. One of the nice things about using these transparents right out of the bottle is they do a really good job of covering colors that they're bright or darker than. So you can see as I'm going over this lighter green with this transparent brown, it's just covering it up perfectly. Why we're working, when we were working on this project, we were working from light to dark. Big thing that we were talking about. A lot differently than how we would normally approach painting a miniature. But it works really well when you're working exclusively with transparents for these base coats and first stage highlights and shadows. And remember, we are going to do a lot of brushwork on this afterwards. But most of that is going to be painting in details. Painting in feathers, stuff like that.
Painting feathers.
Yep.
No idea what you're talking about.
Painting feathers?
Yeah.
I got feathers on this model. There are exactly...
Don't even know how to paint feathers. How do you paint feathers?
15 of them.
How exactly do you paint feathers?
You apply paint to them.
I knew how to paint feathers.
Yeah, me too. I got that about 15 seconds ago.
I'm painting feathers. More than 15 feathers.
No, you're painting a lot of feathers. Oops. A little clip. Do you have a pair of clippers over there? I missed a doohickey.
A doohickey?
Yeah.
What is a feather? You paint them by feathering. What technique do you paint feathers with? Feathering. Seems logical. I would go for that. If I didn't know any better, I would think you were a genius.
If you didn't know any better.
That point where you decide whether or not you want to do detailing on feathers, I think, is the part where you're like, yeah, that's either soul-sucking or easy.
Yep.
Because I'm deciding to do detailing. I probably shouldn't have.
It's brutal.
I'm having second thoughts here, chat. I'm like, there's a lot of feathers here.
Man, I've painted...
And unfortunately, you cannot just feather your feathers.
Have you ever painted the Phoenix from Kingdom Death? Because that thing's got a lot of feathers on it.
No, I try not to paint Kingdom Death if I can avoid it. Painted a lot of the pinups early on. That I... Tempted to not paint much. I do have... Somebody gave me the Flower Knight, I think it is.
I have painted those as well.
Might have been Mo. Schmidt? I can't, I'm gonna offend somebody because I can't remember who gave it to me.
A lot of my friends locally in Washington really liked the game, so they had me paint a lot of their stuff.
Hey, somebody likes us.
Hello. Graphics D.
What is going on? Thank you for the follow.
Thank you for the follow. I think I got that right.
Source says, right about now, I'm starting to think about the next project. No, I'm not there yet. I said I would tell you when I'm there. But good point. I am not there yet. That's not happening. I am thinking about maybe moving on and painting some other part of this model, though. Yeah, the feathers, if they don't paint themselves, we'll come back to it.
If they don't paint themselves.
I mean, every now and then, it doesn't happen to you every now and then. I walk in the studio and stuff's just finished.
Can't say that that's ever happened to me.
No?
Yeah.
Maybe it's that I just walk into the studio and I say I'm not finishing that.
That sounds a lot more likely.
I get those mixed up.
That sounds way more likely.
I get those mixed up sometimes.
All right, we're going to be on painting vines for another 5 or 10 minutes, probably. A lot of them on here.
What you're saying is that Croak is a jungle toad.
He is, in fact, a jungle toad. Floaty, creepy, undead.
Jungle toad.
jungle toad.
What are you talking about? He's a floaty, creepy, undead jungle toad.
Yep. First part where we got to be a little bit more careful on this model to not get stuff covered up. Paint that we're applying. Not so bad. For being a complicated model with a lot of stuff on it, paints pretty nicely, to be honest. The structure of the model itself is pretty sturdy. It doesn't have a bunch of bits and bobs that really are super flimsy, so it lets you hold onto it really nicely. Big bonus when you're painting crazy models like this.
the end of the day, you decide when it's finished. This is true. As an artist, you got to figure out. We see a lot of people talk about, you know, finished, not perfect.
Yep. I mean, this Stegodon is most certainly not perfect.
I think
there's a lot of things on it
only,
that could use a little bit of work.
The only problem I've ever had with that statement is that we assume that we, in that statement, the assumption is that perfect is something assigned by others. And I prefer to think that as artists, we assign our own perfection.
Oh, yeah, 100%.
And perfection is not a definition of things, an objective definition. It's still subjective. So you can very easily say that, you know, this is my version of perfect for Dante.
Well, and the other thing, too, in the vast majority of cases, your opinion is really the only one that matters.
Thank you for saying that, because I do believe my opinion is the only one that matters.
Yes. Other people should generally not be able to tell you when a model is done or not.
Yet.
Except for, you know, when you're painting stuff for other people, and it's their job to tell you that it's done or not.
Well, you know, and that brings up a good point that if you're commissioning or something like that, then sometimes you don't have the opportunity to decide what finished and perfect are.
Correct.
You have to be understanding of those things.
But it also kind of depends on the client, too, because a lot of clients, depending on who they are and what their background is, will just say, hey, I need this thing, and trust you to complete it. And generally, we'll be happy with the result. There are other cases where, you know, people might be a little bit more picky or might have a stronger idea in mind or have a background in art. In the case of, like, a professional job where you're working for a studio, you know, you have expectations of quality levels to match.
Yep.
I've definitely dealt with that a lot with studio painting, right? You gotta match the look and feel for the IP and the brand that you're delivering products for. Things gotta match. And if it doesn't, you gotta keep working on it until it does. Just the name of the game. But outside of that, your opinion is the only one that really matters. Don't let other people dictate for you whether your model looks good. They have their own biases, which are not.
Big Duke says Jordan's opinion of my work is the only opinion that matters.
Hey! Thanks, buddy. Your work's really good, though. You know. I also taught you how to paint, so.
Uh-oh.
There's that.
Uh-oh, so he has some responsibility in this.
Yeah.
That's the way to do it, man. Have somebody teach you how to paint, and then hold them accountable for your mistakes.
Yep. It's true.
Wait a minute, I shouldn't say that.
It's true.
I've been teaching people for decades.
He's
I don't want all of the... that's too much responsibility!
He's done some fantastic work. And made some seriously crazy impressive growth. Since we started teaching him. So, kudos, Big Duke. Yeah, nice part is if I fail, I could just blame Jordan exactly. But then I turn it around and I'm like, hey, remember this time that we talked about this thing that you should probably be doing when you're painting that you didn't do here very obviously? And then you go... Yeah, that's right. Oops.
I'll get back to you on that.
Yeah. Hey, I need another...
That's where you go, hey, I wasn't done yet, Mr. Fancy Pants. Which, by the way, right? By the way, Big Duke, that's exactly what Jordan did to me when he didn't finish his Horus, and we caught him.
I don't know what you're talking about.
See?
You guys did not catch it. And
we
therefore,
sure did.
Well, not until after the vote.
That's true.
Which
well, it's
is
actually
all that matters.
During the vote. And somehow, they still took pity on you.
Votes were cast. Look, I'll put it this way. We tied and my model wasn't even done.
Here we go.
I'm just saying. Imagine what would have happened if my model was completely finished.
Here we go.
I took it easy on you.
Here we go, chat. Be one of those days.
It's always one of those days around here. My positivity comes with a caveat.
That it's not really positive. I taught you about licking models. No, I think you taught me that. I'm going to plead the fifth.
How's it going, Big Duke? I hope you're having a good time. Thanks for tuning into the stream. It's good to see ya. Hope your conquest is going well. Hey, building Kagos models and chilling. That's what's up. I knew it. What are you building? City-states? Nice. Gonna paint them look like Spartans? That's cool. Heck yeah. Don't forget to share with the class. I'll send some photos out later.
First dibs when he gets paint on him, what, to buy them?
No.
Oh.
To see him. I'll have to get a conquest army put together and painted so that next time I come down there, or up there, I can bring an army and we can play. How's it going, Tim?
We get a lumberjack.
We got a lumberjack. Lumberjack has arrived. Are you on the road again? Oh, thank you, Tim. I'm glad you enjoyed the sultry tones of my voice over the interwebs. Attached to videos of me unboxing some very cool Procrill box sets. Heading home from North Jersey, nice. How long is that trek?
Not bad.
Not
He's
bad.
In PA, so.
Oh, okay, yeah.
That's an easy jaunt. That really brought him to life.
The texture on the wings?
Just yeah, a little bit of highlight.
Looks really good.
Seeing white-blue.
Oh, nice. Oh, nice little cold white. Source, any chance you'll show off the metallics in today's stream? Just a quick comparison between them so we can see how to apply. Yeah, absolutely. I'm going to use metallics on this today. Are there any in particular you wanted to see, Source? The kit? Okay, we can go through.
White blue is one of your fave new colors. It's so good, right? So good.
And all the colors from those signature sets have been absolutely a pleasure to use.
Well, that's your last appointment for the day, Tim. That's awesome.
Two hours. That's not too bad. Because it's what? It's like coming up on 3:30 over where you're at. So you'll be home by like 5:30. That's not too bad. 5:36. That's pretty reasonable, if I do say so myself.
This is coming from somebody that gets off at 4 and is home by 4:03.
Yes, that is accurate.
If we were to leave at the same time and I thought I lived close, you'd be home before me.
Yeah, my
I'm very jealous.
My whole perspective of like what is close and what is not close
has been
is
ruined
totally
forever.
Screwed. Yeah.
Yeah, it's been ruined forever. When we were looking at the apartment with Baby Jay when he came down here initially, we were like I looked at Jen and I go, I would move here.
Yes.
Not because I necessarily want to live in an apartment, but because it's so close.
Yeah.
Like, legit, I could find myself living over there.
And I mean, to be honest, the facilities are pretty nice.
No, it's nice. It is a neat apartment.
Yeah.
I never thought about it. Our first office was, we showed it to you. It was the building right next to you.
Yep.
Over there.
Yep.
So, we saw that apartment every single day. And I just never even gave it a second thought. And then, as Carter and some of the other guys who work here were like looking for places to live, I started saying, well, I mean, there's that apartment complex right there. And it's got to be good because it's, I mean, well, it doesn't, close and good don't mean they don't go together necessarily. But I was like, it can't be that bad if it's that close, was kind of my thinking.
Yeah, for sure.
And then you see it and it's actually a neat apartment complex. It's older, but it's nice.
Yeah. And it was a little touch and go at the beginning, but, you know.
Well, that was unfortunate, but.
Yeah. But we worked through that challenging bit, and we've arrived on the other side unscathed with a great apartment. So, yeah, I'm not moving out of this apartment anytime soon. I'm perfectly content and happy with the apartment as is. As long as they don't, like, bump my rent up like crazy.
$5 million.
Yeah, that would suck. But yeah, Big Duke, if you're still here, I'm thinking about getting a cat. I know we've talked about this in the past. I guess to chat as well, I'm thinking about getting a cat. I'm excited. I like cats. Cats are great. Get a cat!
Get a cat!
I gotta make sure I don't get a Miri, though.
What?
Big Duke's cat's name is Miri. And she's a bit of a terror. In the best of ways.
In the best of ways.
She's,
I mean,
she's a
nice...
wonderful cat. But she is a bit of a terror. Yeah, Miri... Miri is great. But Miri keeps it a bit too real. To be fair, though, that's all mostly your fault. You be playing with her in such ways that she gonna be smacking you upside the head with claws. She loved you, though. She got that cat-like affection. Even though the
well,
be
dogs are
you.
Better, cats are better for apartments. This is true.
Yeah,
this is true. Always get a dog if you have the opportunity. Don't get a cat.
I don't think I would be a very good dog owner. I keep a
dogs
little
lead
too busy.
More, a lot more interaction.
Yeah, cats are generally pretty happy to just like chill.
Yeah, cats are more self-maintaining, other than cleaning litter boxes and stuff.
Yeah, I play with them a little bit, but not nearly to the extent that, like, a dog needs attention. I mean, they both kind of break all your stuff, to be fair. I'd just be worried about a cat tearing up my couches. That would be the big bummer. Got some lines done. That's pretty awesome, Shard. Yeah. I love me some cats. The nice thing, though, Tim, is I have a lot of... All of my stuff that's fragile, like my models, are just in cases. So I don't have a lot of stuff that can get knocked over at this point. Thanks, Shard. I am very happy with it so far. This has all been transparent paints and washes.
Your cat follows you around. That's like my dog.
About 2 hours worth of work so far. Not a whole lot at all, to be honest.
Laura gets very bummed if I get up off the couch to go to my office at night and close the hallway gate so she can't get to my office.
That's funny. What on earth are you doing? And why are you not letting me be?
Yeah, exactly. Why can't I come, Dad?
All right, what color are all these snakes going to be?
All colors.
Yeah.
King snakes.
Huh?
King snakes.
What? Red?
Red. Gold. Black. Banded.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking, is banded reds. Red it is. We'll do some, like, red and some... golden yellow ones. Maybe a black one here or there. Let's burnt red. Right in front of my face.
Yeah, the dog won't sneak up on you and smack you in the head a bunch of times while you're minding your own business. Cats, on the other hand,
they don't care. No. They just want your attention, and they will... whatever they want to get it.
Now is the time where you pay attention. I mean, my dog jumps up on the couch and is like, now's the time where you pay attention to me. He gets right in front of your face. That's pretty much the whole time I'm in the living room. Your black cat will follow you around biting your calves and jump attacking you. Oh, cats.
What ridiculous animals they are.
What ridiculous animals they are.
See what I'm doing.
You hate cats? They're the only animal you hate in any way or dislike in any way, really?
That's a bummer. Sorry to hear that.
Cats were never my first choice in pets growing up. And then as I got older and traveled more, and realize that, you know, cats are like the perfect travel owner or traveling owner pet. I nearly gave in, but I never did. I'm a dog guy. Not afraid to admit it. Which for a lot of my life has meant that I didn't have pets. Because unfortunately, traveling most of my life, I learned the hard way that I just didn't have it in me to put my dog in a kennel. I had a dog when I was living in Connecticut that would have to go in the kennel all the time when I traveled, and it just sucked. You could tell it took a lot out of the poor guy. Not a happy camper. Dad gone all the time. Made me sad. No, the dog was sad. I didn't have a pet of any kind. I lived vicariously through my mom and friends' pets, hang out at their houses, play with their dogs, until moving here and meeting Jen. Jen had two dogs when we met. Both of those dogs have since passed, and we got Cora.
You love that dog, though.
Oh my God, I love my dog. You don't have to tell me. I think it's pretty visible.
Yeah.
I'm like, I gotta go home. I gotta go pet the dog's belly. I love her, and then I despise her. It's definitely right. A love hate. You don't get out of my face. I'm punching you in the nose and throwing you off the couch. Because she's like, I took that picture on Sunday in my post, and she just will not leave you alone. There are some days where she is so needy. Right up in your face.
Big smiles, long miles. Do you have a good wash ratio, paint to water or thinner? It depends on what I'm making the wash out of. If I'm making a wash out of transparent, I use more glaze and wash medium and a little bit less water.
Professor Mortis, thank you for the follow.
Yes, thank you for the follow. If I'm using just a paint without any glaze wash medium, I'll use a little bit more water. It's more of a consistency that you want to find instead of a mix ratio. But generally speaking, I would say for a wash, I would put 2 drops of paint to, say, 2 drops of medium and 5 drops of water is like a pretty good idea of what I would typically do for a wash. Maybe a touch less.
Really just depends, you know.
Because you can also get different, like, intensities of wash as
right.
well. Right. So if you want a really intense wash, you'll use a little bit less water. If you want it to be a little bit more transparent, you just add more glaze and wash medium, and then add a little bit more water as well to carry over the mixture, but make it more transparent. Have you guys posted any in-depth videos regarding using the medium for different effects or techniques?
Yeah, if you go look on the YouTube, I did a series of showing you how to use the medium as more of a contrast paint. To paint all of the skin and bits on a model.
It's also what I've been doing for the last couple of days, or last day, I should say.
Yeah, I think that's
like pretty much all of this model has been painted using that style. And if you missed out on yesterday, you can go check out the VOD after the stream to get that. The last half of that stream, about an hour and a half, was me taking this model from basically just a Zenithal up to basically this, minus the vines and the snakes being painted.
The Dork Depot. What a great name. Welcome.
Yeah. Lots of resources. We love to talk about it. We love to give you guys all the strats and techniques. So if you ever have any questions, feel free to ask us. We love to impart knowledge.
Indeed.
I'm just putting some base coats on these snakes, and then we're going to give them a little bit of like a dry brush and some detail work just to make them stand out a little bit. Not going to spend too long on them because, like I said, this is a tabletop project where the goal is to paint it quick so that I don't have to spend a ton of time on it. But we want it to look nice, so we're trying to find as many cheaty ways as possible to get good results on a short timeline.
And I'm painting Dante.
And this man's painting Dante.
Like, I'm not really doing anything other than just painting. Lots of layers. Blazing pyrrole red over my dark blue and burnt red right now. Dial in my red the way I like it. Oh, where's my burnt red? Washing bright poxwalkers, you try the transparent green, maybe use dark yellow green if I don't like the transparent. Transparent and transparent yellow, like Tim is saying, will get you a long way there. Because you can make a bright yellow green wash or transparent that works great. Like when I was doing my orcs, I used the bright yellow green, or the transparent yellow and transparent green as kind of a pseudo filter or wash over the top of the skin here. I started with transparent purple, then into transparent orange, and then the transparent green yellow mix on the top on a Zenithal model. So you get, you know, a better green, but you want to start, depending on how you're layering, right? If you're going over a Zenithal value setup where you have black and white already on the model, then you want to make sure you go a little bit darker with the color than you want it to look at the end, because the white will brighten it up for you naturally. Whereas if you're going over darker colors, then you're going to want it to have, you know, closer to the actual brightness that you're expecting.
All right, so we got some snakes painted. And we're going to do bone protrusions. Protrusions. Bone details. Bone spikes. There we go. In dark golden brown. Just lay on some color real fast. And we're going to dry brush this up to brighten it up. I like using dark golden brown as a base coat for bone. It's a really nice one for like a muddy, mossy bone. Because it's got a little bit of that green in it. You really get that sense of foresty, earthy tones. I like it a lot. think after this we're going to go for a quick dry brush step on the palanquin to get that brightness back up.
Space lizards riding dinosaurs are greater than space marines. I don't know. Put Dante and his Meltapista up against Croak any day. I think Croak will have more holes in him.
I don't know about that. He'd probably survive getting holes put in him, too. Pretty durable.
Lion created what's going on.
Might make his sword.
And thank you, Dork Depot. I am doing this as day, I guess technically the second half of day 3 on Dante, right?
Something like that.
Going pretty quick. Some highlight on the long feathers on the wings. So that we move it a little bit more towards white. Now back on detail colors.
Also going to give this dark golden brown color to some of the spots that are going to be gold as well, just to give a little bit of a warmer brown undercoat for that gold when we put it on. Help to apply it in less coats, especially over this black or dark gray palanquin that we've got going on. Little gravity boosters on the bottom of this thing. Those all painted up. Spikes.
Hope everybody's midweek is going all right. Hump day.
Wonderful little Wednesday. I cannot complain. I'm feeling pretty good today.
Good. Sounding a lot better.
Oh, yeah. I am not coughing nearly as much today. Last night.
Of course, it's easy for me to say because it's like day one with no Jordan in my life.
It's true. He's so sad.
Jordan's office got moved. So, this morning, I saw him chatting in Discord and on our office chat, and I'm like, what, is he working from home? Because he wasn't in the office next to me today.
Buddy. Only it made more sense. But I think the current setup makes more sense.
Oh, yeah, it definitely does. But now, chat, I have strategically been placed by myself.
You know who did that, chat?
Myself.
He did. He gets all the responsibility for that one.
I say it was strategic. is pyro red and orange mixed together.
Good combination of colors. Except for the tabard.
Yeah, it's the way I've been working up the armor. So since he doesn't have any red, I can kind of cheat and use it on his tabard. Whereas I wouldn't use this same color combo on any of the other Marines because it's the way the armor is worked up. So I wouldn't necessarily use the same red-orange if they had cloth on them because you'd want to find another combo. But he doesn't have any other red except for the blood jewels that he'll have on him, so I'm not as worried about it.
Really like the red cape that Alex Does Minis posted. Got on his mini that he posted in Discord.
Yeah.
Coming along really nice. Alex Does Minis is one of our newest monumentals.
Tremendous
to
painter.
Join. He's a fantastic painter.
I believe out of Montreal.
Yeah.
Quebec.
Yep.
Oh. Quebecois.
Nice. Wonderful Canadian. This guy. Very excited to show off our paints and show all the cool stuff that he's doing with them. There's upcoming projects. Very exciting. But yeah, that red definitely very similar to what you're doing over there.
New colors, but any plans for dry pigments in the future? Probably not.
Starting like weathering powders?
Yeah, what would you use them for? There's like a little blip in our hobby right now where people are like, put it in with medium, make paint out of it. I'm like, eh.
No. That sort of stuff is best used for like weathering powders.
Yeah, but they're anything. Totally different products.
Yes.
So. But no, we're not trying to work on dry pigments. I won't rule it out entirely from a weathering perspective down the road. But not something that's on my radar right now. Got a lot of other stuff.
A lot of higher priority stuff on the docket to get through.
We're working on. Yeah.
Also very exciting stuff, so don't feel like you're losing out on stuff, because all the stuff that we've got coming up is pretty awesome. RoboCorpse, is just me or is the video not only very bright, but contrast is turned down?
How do you mean?
Looks fine to me.
You're seeing exactly what I'm seeing. Mine might be a little bright because I'm blowing out the camera with so much brightness on him with white and all that. I can probably adjust my contrast down a bit. Maybe like so.
Oh, that looks nice.
On my side. That's a little bit more in tune with reality. The camera gets blown out a little bit by the soft highlights that I put on here, because they are ultra bright. It hurts your brain. Painting bright, man. Yeah, the cameras we use are as close to what we are seeing. Now, granted, that's somewhat subjective to our eyes, but Jordan and I dial them in to where it's... We look at our screens.
We dial them in every day, too, so...
We look at our models, and that's what it is. And we do have to adjust. I didn't adjust for Dante with the brightness, but... We won't get any Hollywood fanciness here. Well, a lot of streamers will take contrast and shadows down to boost the actual visual contrast on models. And you won't find that here. It's truly what you see is what you get.
Work on croak here for a minute. And we're gonna do some gold.
Games are just more vibrant? What are you talking about? Like video games?
I think that's...
Oh, heck yeah. No camera in the way. Great color information on a video card. Brighten that back up too much, but I'm happy with it. More used to watching games. Yeah. Oh, definitely, right? Because you don't have light in between the signal and your eyes. You're all digital all the time. Video game. You're only worried on the video game side about compression, maybe. Losing some information and color and detail, but that. I figure out how to highlight. What do we want to use to highlight? Maybe that's a future me problem.
Highlight what? The red?
The red.
Oh, looks pretty good to me.
Fall to future me. I don't know that I want to jump from where I'm at to pale pink. Don't know that I want to use pink. Pink could be the next step.
I think you could use pale yellow.
Flesh. I'm going to go for warm flesh.
Warm flesh would be good?
Yeah, warm flesh is the answer.
I like the idea of mixing red with a little bit of pale yellow. Also,
no.
A good idea. No, you don't like that?
No.
Okay.
No.
Just an idea.
Not the boss of me.
Well, that's true.
Thinking.
You are, in fact, the boss of me.
And maybe a little bit too much of a jump, but we're going to do it anyway. Warm flesh mixed in with the color that we just used is the eclectic salmon that we highlighted everything else with. But I think I want to take a little bit bigger jump than that. Might be too much. Get really, really thin first. I like that. Running it super, super thin, as you can see here. First pass.
What mix do you recommend when running your black primer through an airbrush? No mix. Don't thin it.
Our primer?
Yeah.
Don't thin our primer.
Don't thin our primer. Just toss it right in the airbrush and spray away. That's all you need.
What makes our primer special is that we formulated it to be super easy to clean up, super easy to use. Squirt it in the brush, paint, go.
I mean, you just asked us for what to do. So, you can listen to us or not.
What's the deal?
He was just like, listen, you're not my real dad. Don't tell me what to do. I'm like, well.
Don't tell me what to do.
You just asked me to tell you.
He's like, wait a minute. Have you had too much sugar today, son? Did your mother feed you too much sugar today?
Being a little sarcastic back. Gotta mess with your back. We gotta give it as good as we get it. Jason would not want me to do any less. Okay, maybe he would. But
oh boy.
Maybe he would. Hard to tell. Oops.
No, but in all seriousness, you don't have to thin. You can mix it.
Right out of the box.
You can mix it. You can thin it when you're doing things other than priming. So if you want to do, you know, like a zenithal highlight and you're not really, going for full brightness on your white, then you can definitely thin the white. But just doing prime base coats, it's much better with our primer to not thin it at all. You can run it through a 0.3 needle with no thinning, no problem at all.
All right, source, here we go. We're starting with some rich gold. I'm using a ton of this right now. Got a lot of gold to paint. Oh, before we do that, actually, I need to do something else. What color did I want to do for that? Right, warm gray? Where are you? Warm gray. There we go. Do a little bit of dry brushing on this stone. I get my handy dandy dry brush. Apply some of that. Gonna dry brush it on. Source, what PSI? We typically run at what, 25 to 30? 20 to 25?
30? 20 to 25. I think we're like at 23 right now. So
for me, 25 has always been a good sweet spot for PSI. Just to make sure that I get really nice and consistent flow. For the paint that I'm throwing through the airbrush.
There we go.
Your airbrush isn't what determines the PSI, it's your compressor.
You have an Iwata? We, like Jordan said, we shoot at about 22 to 25 PSI for everything and do not adjust.
Correct.
There really isn't, when working with the types of viscosities that we're working with in liquid acrylics, there's not much need to adjust PSI. Now, as you're beginning and learning airbrushing, being able to alter the PSI can sometimes get you more comfortable with thinner paints, right? Turn down the PSI the thinner you go. In order to avoid spatter, like you've mentioned, or what's even worse when you're painting with very thin paints, is that you get spider webbing. It fingers out. But the real culprit there is not necessarily the pressure. It's how you're using the machine, right? So when you watch me airbrush, let's back out a little bit. When you watch me airbrush, you'll notice that I'm constantly kind of moving the airbrush like this, right? Looks like I have some sort of the shakes or a palsy. But the idea here is that you're never allowing paint to hit the same spot on the model for too long, which allows me to paint ultra thin. Like, I can thin the paint down to next to nothing, like pure water. Whereas if you were to go in there and pull the trigger with the thinness of paint that I use and you just hold the brush still, and it'll spider web out. It'll grow those fingers and spatter, right? Because you have so much paint hitting one single spot that it overloads it and has to move someplace else. So constantly moving the brush a little bit, right? You can do it in very, very tiny circles when you're going in to, like, do the cheek on his helmet. If I were going to highlight it, I'd still just do like this and build in a small one. Or you wind up going in and just kind of pulsing, just kind of barely hitting the trigger to build up paint, because that way you still only get a small amount of paint in the location that you're aiming at. So when doing fine details, just make sure you're not going full pressure, full trigger pull, and holding, right? Because you will put way too much paint on the model. Now, the thicker the paint gets, so if you use Perlcurl right out of the bottle into the airbrush, the longer you can hold it still, but you still want to practice that, keep the needle moving, because you will overload paint no matter what. Because the airbrush puts out a tremendous amount of paint in a very short period of time, and for the size needles we're using, in a very small area on the model, unless, of course, you pull back a foot, at which point the cone of spray is monstrous. You don't really ever want to be painting further away than about 4 to 6 inches from the model. And with that distance, you know, you're going to get a whole lot of paint in the area you're aiming at. Got to be careful.
So that's what we're looking like with a little bit of a dry brush.
Valandar, what's going on? Source does. Your airbrush max is out at 20 PSI. Do you have like a handheld one or like a small, like weird hobby one?
It would probably have to be.
Like if it's one of the small portable ones, then yeah, they generally won't go high enough. And they won't deliver consistent pressure anyway. So I never recommend those for doing things like what we do here when you really want. It's, well, for base coating, fantastic. For detail work, not so much. Right?
Yeah.
You want something that can deliver a consistent amount of pressure. And like we have ours, the output of our compressor is set at 60 PSI. And then we have a regulator here at the bench that sets it down to where we want to use it for actual use. So the 60 PSI guarantees us that we have more than enough pressure in the line all the way up to the splitter, right? And then the pressure valve or regulator here at the desk, we set to 23 PSI, 24 PSI, and spray from that. And that way he and I can both be spraying at the same time and always have a solid, consistent 25 PSI because we're feeding it with 60. Source, just bought it for priming. Yeah, you're fine for that. If you're not worried, if you're just doing solid coats on an entire surface, fine. Great. Good purchase. Great way to save money, get into a neat tool to be able to do priming and base coating with. Because you can do your base coating with it and probably your first stage highlight with it too. But once you start getting into narrower and narrower spots that you want to spray, having that inconsistent pressure from that battery-operated compressor at 20 PSI topping out means it's never really delivering 20 PSI. You're probably in the 12 to 15 range nominal all the time, and you'll start to see it kind of, if you were to hold it and just press the trigger and pull back, you might see the amount of paint growing and stopping as it pulses, because it can't deliver constant pressure that way. So just be careful trying to get that particular compressor to do detail work. And when you do move up to a compressor where you're wanting to do finer details and learn more technique, get one with a tank.
Yep.
With a reservoir, air reservoir, of a minimum of a liter and a half to 2 liter tank, gallon tank would be perfect. That makes the air pressure consistent. So that, because none of the motors will give deliver consistent air, right? The motors either have a piston and are running or pistonless and still have an oscillation in the motor. And so it delivers high, low, high, low, high, low pressure as it fills to its standard. And so the tank evens all that out. If you don't have a tank, your hose is acting at this tank, and the hose doesn't hold enough air to make a difference.
All right, so that's the result of the dry brush.
Unless you buy a 50-foot hose and coil it up on the floor.
Picking
and
up a lot of that
acts like a tank.
Detail in the areas on the palanquin here.
Source does, but question remains, would you need to thin your primer with such a compressor? I wouldn't. Unless you just absolutely have problems spraying it, you shouldn't need to. No. Oh yeah, an airbrush pays for itself almost the first time you use it. You know, if you don't go all out and buy, like, you know, the most expensive Harder and Steenbeck, you know, with a $500 compressor or something. And even then, in a year or two, it pays for itself no matter what. Of course, that's all relative to how many models you paint, because you can tell that so many $20 spray cans of primer and you've bought an air compressor and an airbrush. And you'll always use the air compressor. Well, I say always. And until it dies or something untoward happens, you'll use that machine setup and spend, you know, our primer's like, what, $16?
Yeah, it's
$15 a bottle. And, I mean, we spray a lot of models with a bottle of primer out here.
Lasts a very long time.
Robocorp skipped all the money and just blows through a hose. Oh, yeah. Siphon airbrushes are a thing. Seen the TikTok of the European dudes sitting there and blowing through a straw with a siphon airbrush to paint cars when they fix dents and stuff. It's doable.
All right, now we're just hitting these outer rings with a little bit of faded green. Bring this edge detail back up. Nice. It's all about these dry brush layers after you go in and you paint with the glazes using the the transparents. Because this detail work that you're bringing back in with this dry brush will really help add a little bit more of that contrast and get the details to pop. This is one of the more important steps. And I'm even hitting these areas in the recesses just to redefine some of the detail there. Not going as heavy. We still want to see all that detail. Those parts. Ends up being kind of like a nice little edge highlight that we're end up creating for this. On the bottom there, it just adds a little bit of that definition. This is super quick. Does not take very long to get all this dry brush color down.
Founder, yeah, exactly. If you're doing base coats, I mean, until, honestly, until you want to start doing detail work with your airbrush. And by detail work, I mean things like, you know, going in and cleaning up blends with your brush late in the day with your model, that kind of stuff, then there is absolutely no reason to fret about, you know, the price or whatever you're spending on your airbrush. Now, once you decide that what you want to do is higher detail, you know, very fine spray, very tight end work, then you need to start looking at, you know, what compressor, that kind of stuff. I didn't really explain. I took the warm flesh and I kind of roughed it in on where I wanted my highlight lines, and then I took the red and orange mixture and glazed it over the top on that backside so that you get a nice highlight that doesn't seem too hard edge. This I'm really liking.
Gravewalker UK, thank you for the follow. Welcome.
Hello.
Hello.
Well, hello.
Oh, hello.
Hey, somebody likes us.
How much paint are you leaving on your brush with the ProCrill paints when dry brushing? I get pretty much all of it off. You don't need very much on there when you're doing the dry brushing. Because I'm just trying to catch the edges. I'm not trying to add any paint buildup. So we're just getting that nice detail. Edge highlights with the dry brushes, which is the goal. Looking pretty good. Remember, this is like 3 hours in, a little less than 3 hours in on this thing. Probably going to be 5 hours, 6 hours.
Yes, welcome back.
Might take just about the amount of time that the slam took, to be honest. Because we did two long streams for the slam, so it ended up being about 6 hours. I'm at three right now. Because we started halfway through stream yesterday. Yeah, we'll crush through this thing. I'm all about it. We're going to do a little bit of a dry brush up here. Bring that detail up.
Jake, yeah, we'll be at Gen Con.
Yes, sir. I'm very excited about it. Gotta get a chance to visit with my dad, hopefully, one of the evenings. Lives in Indy. Cool. Family down there. Whole lot of family down there now, apparently. With the brother and sister-in-laws. Stepmother. That's Baby J's monthly birthday. That's true. Happy birthday, me.
Done. Are we exhibiting anything or at the booth only? I don't understand the question. Exhibiting like off, like somewhere else? We'll have all the product at the booth. We don't do anything outside of that. We support and sponsor the classrooms, the miniature classrooms, so we'll have a lot of our paint in the miniature classrooms. But that's all we do. Talk John into doing a video on straw airbrushing. It doesn't work for detail stuff very well. We should do like a whole like paint a model with a siphon airbrush.
Oh, gosh.
Oh, that'd be horrible. Makes me want to break out into hives just thinking about it. made a Gen Con brush joke. What, like we might have brushes? If we get brushes, when I think we're going to get brushes, which is here in a couple weeks,
it's entirely possible we'll be sold out.
No, we'll be sold out, and I don't know that we'll have new ones by the time Gen Con rolls around. So, you know, not as big a joke as it seems. Yeah, we will sell out of brushes within weeks.
Yeah.
Even though it's intended to be much more than week's supply. We already know.
Just by how many people have been asking about it.
Yeah, it's
we just
ridiculous.
Know it's gonna be, they're gonna fly off the shelves. So make sure if you want brushes, you guys, that you are on top of watching the social media posts for when we announce that we have them, so you guys can get your hands on some before they get sold out. We ordered a decent amount, so like we will have some, but a lot of people want brushes. So sign up for all the notifications, get into the Discord. All those places are good places to keep an eye on it. Thank you, Tim. I really like how this thing's turning out.
Good. Blowing through it.
Yeah. No joke. You're going fast. All right, Source, here we go.
I couldn't do that.
Gold. Can't do that?
I couldn't do it with Croak. It's a model that I would be too excited to paint to do it that way. Techless, I didn't have a problem because I didn't really care about the Techless model. Big model, centerpiece model, was easy to paint quick. Croak, I don't know if I could do it. There's certain ones, right? It's like,
yeah.
It's like I look at it and I'm like, oh no, I got to spend more time. You know? I mean, we did the non-metallic gold in one sitting on stream on this, but I can't leave well enough alone. I can't have that be all we do. So
yep.
I had to go back in and
yep.
continually work and rework. I could probably start with the mindset on something like Croak that I do it quickly.
Yeah.
But it's just that particular model.
Well, I think for...
Not big centerpiece models. It's not that I can't paint them quick. It's just that particular model, I just dig that model.
Yeah. I think, well, I mean, for this, I think it'll look really nice when it's all done. It won't be like display quality, but the other part of it is like if I spent the time that it would take to get it to display quality, I'd be painting this thing forever. I'd never get anything else done.
That's why I don't have Croak.
Yeah.
This is why my adult brain cell kicks in. And there's a reason why there's some models I don't have. Because I'm like, I couldn't do it. It would take me forever.
My goal is to get this army done before Shatterpoint comes up.
Before what?
Shatterpoint.
Shadow what?
Shatterpoint.
Shatterpoint.
Yeah.
Which is like next weekend.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't it?
Yes. I think it is, actually.
I don't remember.
That's the 2nd, so whenever that is.
The 2nd of June?
Yeah.
Oh, Jesus. Yeah, it's next weekend. Not this coming.
Yeah, so I have the rest of this week and next week.
Because my birthday's next Tuesday. That's the 30th. 31st, Wednesday, 1st, Thursday.
It's a Friday.
2nd Friday, yeah.
Because I won't be able to start Shatterpoint until the following week. Because I won't have it until Friday. And I'll have to get it after work on Friday.
I mean, you know those people. Why don't you have one here?
I mean,
I can't remember who it was. I think it was Will came in chat and said, hey, would you guys like to paint Shatterpoint?
I mean, I can message
him. And I said, yes, talk to your boy, and we'd love to get some in.
Oh, okay. Well, I'll go message him tonight.
And he didn't do it.
I'll message him tonight.
He never answered. So maybe he said it, I didn't answer him quick enough, and he split or something. I don't know.
Yeah.
Know those guys. They'll send you some models.
Yeah, I'll message them. I'll message Dallas. And Will. See what I can... I'll message all of my friends over there. Somebody will make it happen. Tony. Pagani.
Somebody Dallas, will make it happen.
Josh. Dick. Someone over there.
I mean, do I have one flash? Ooh. Ivory?
Would you want some Chatterpoint to be on stream?
Dark Ivory? No.
No? Okay.
Nah, I don't care about Star Wars. I don't think I would do it justice unless there's a model that I have. I mean, I haven't looked at it, so there's probably a model I would really like to paint. But I don't know what it is.
Of the characters in Star Wars, is there one that you would be more interested in painting than not?
That's a loaded question.
All right. How about I just tell you?
I don't know anybody. I would have to see pictures. I'm not going to know who they are.
Fair enough. Fair enough.
I'm like, oh, that's a neat model. I'm that guy. Where I'm like, ooh, I'd paint that.
I actually really like all the stormtroopers. I think they look really good.
Yeah, the Bad Batch looking guys. Are pretty cool. I've seen a lot of people paint them up.
Yeah, I know T. Schmidt's been painting up some stuff. Ridian's been painting up stuff.
Yeah, we've been seeing a lot in the Discord.
Yeah, it's making me jealous.
All these people that work at stores painting the store copies. Where are my sexy Star Wars figures? They're over in the case in the other room. There was a time in the last couple of weeks where I thought about painting the Stormtrooper one over. Right? Oh, you know what it was? It was May the 4th.
Yep.
And 5th. I went over there and Jordan and I were looking and I was like, oh, we can do these.
And then you were like,
I don't want to paint it.
I don't care about Star Wars.
I was like, I don't care enough about Star Wars to repaint this model. That kind of sucks. Good idea. Wasn't going to happen.
Yeah, I offered to bring in some Legion. Legion models so you could paint. Nah.
I really just don't care enough about it. It doesn't get me jazzed. There's not a character in Star Wars. It's the same with the Marvel stuff. I was just talking about it last night with Dave and Jake from Build, Paint, Play, because I went and did that podcast. And I don't remember if it was during the podcast or after we shut down, but I was talking about the fact that I just don't really like painting, you know, superheroes. I don't like painting Star Wars. I don't like painting Batman, you know, Marvel. None of that where the IP is so well known, you know, because it doesn't give me the freedom as an artist that I want, which is to paint it however I want to. You know, now I'm looking at Dante here, and I know Dante has gold armor, and I wanted to paint Dante's gold armor as part of my Blood Angels. But I don't care if I paint it in different golds or whatever. This character feels more generic. We've made it my own.
I mean, you've also added wings and stuff on
it. Yeah,
like,
I feel like that's not
you've really
something
customized
that I enjoy about Spider-Man or something, you know, like painting Marvel Crisis Protocol and taking Iron Man and saying, oh, but you can paint him whatever color you want. I'm like, yeah, but I'm not inspired to paint him anything other than Iron Man.
Yeah.
And I grew up in comics, right?
Well,
one of my goals in life was to draw a comic book. And so I drew all these characters so much of my life that I'm like, yeah, kind of over it. That's why we did Black Order for MCU, because they didn't have a expected color scheme. They weren't well known enough, other than Thanos, to feel like, oh, they have to look like this or you're doing it wrong. And I know most of that's self-inflicted. Nobody cares. You know, I did paint my Black Order in different colors. I did paint my Thanos in jades instead of his regular colors. And I know you're free to do whatever you want. It just doesn't inspire me, I guess. RPG miniatures. Yeah, Valandar, stuff where it's, like, open-ended. Like, you get a miniature and you're like, okay, go. Like, you know, let's go. I can do whatever I want to do with this guy and turn it into whatever I want. And everybody will look at it for the artistic expression rather than any pre-made conception or preformed conception of what it's intended to be. Whereas you hand somebody pink Spider-Man, right, or yellow Spider-Man, and it's like, oh, I don't know this Spider-Man. And so that gets in the way of the appreciation of the artwork.
I think it helps that I just enjoy painting things in their traditional...
Well, you like box art painting.
Yeah.
You've mentioned that a bunch, and I think that's great.
Yeah, I come from a background of doing box art. I enjoy to replicate that kind of... I find it entertaining, and for me...
Well, you say you come from a box art painting pedigree, but that's... You were creating the box art. You didn't have a guide, other than your art director.
Well, yeah, I mean, that is
the
guide,
you're creating
right? The
color scheme. So well, very different from copying the color
not scheme. For War Machine. War Machine, those color schemes were all already created.
I guess that's true.
I had
too.
To copy them, yeah.
I guess that's true. You had to match Signar to Signar, and right. Color palettes were the same, but you were creating yeah. that model.
I have done
in a lot of cases, creation. You were creating that model for the first time.
Correct, in a lot of instances.
So that's very different than painting Spider-Man. That's
yes.
been around since longer than you've been alive.
But I have done a lot of, you know, paint this Protectorate of Menoth guy, and it's like, okay... We pull up the recipe for Protectorate of Menoth.
Yeah, oh, yeah. No, that, I get right? that. I get that when there's a color scheme that you have to go by, right?
Yeah. But I have done a lot, like, all of the Rivenstone stuff that I painted. Like, that was all custom recipes that I created.
Yeah, and that's cool.
It's you know, it's one of those things where sometimes my brain gets a little burnt out of trying to, like, create new stuff. And sometimes it's nice to just, like, autopilot... And just paint stuff?
Well, yeah, I mean, I do agree that if you've got the palette given to you, like here's the colors yeah. that this model needs to be in, that there is some sort of, there's still a freedom in that if
yeah.
you can use the palette how you want.
Correct, exactly.
Right? We do that with the limited palette challenges.
Yep.
Here's five colors, make it work. I enjoy that because it's a challenge. It's a, hey, now I get to find a way to make this creative vision come true. You know, but I don't have all the tools that I would normally go to. And so that I really dig. And it's very similar when somebody gives you a palette. Like, you know, when I would do commission work and a commissioner would be like, okay, I really want these in XYZ. And I might not look at the model and immediately think of those colors, but it gives you a challenge and you
yeah.
get it done.
Yep.
But then it comes to stuff like Batman. And I'm like, yeah, I'm just not feeling the same old Batman colors, you know. Now, how... It can be expressed, like, how can you make it feel like Batman in your own way? You know, how can I pull off that, you know, black, gray, blue kind of Batman feel? There's some neat stuff to do, so I'm not downplaying the interest that people may have in it. Just not for me.
Yeah, that's totally fine.
It's why Legion, I think, got me a little bit more interested in Star Wars. Because you could paint, you know, Rebel Infantry Dude 462.
Yeah.
And Rebel Infantry Dude 462 had no rules, right? He could literally wear any colors. That's why I did Rebels. Because it felt like, you know, just painting any military. Kind of like Astra Militarum, right? Kind of the Imperial Guard. It was
yeah.
like painting Imperial Guard. You'd do whatever you want. So that was kind of cool. But then it got to where, oh, but you have to have... commanders. And oh, if you want to play this, you gotta hit Luke Skywalker is the guy you want to use. Like, I really don't want to paint Luke Skywalker or Princess Leia.
Yeah, let me just have just like generic dude number 5.
Yeah, exactly.
Which you can do.
I know.
Yeah.
They and, even had commanders that were just generic commanders.
Yep. They do give you that ability.
I just prefer IP for painting that is not stuff that's as well known. Now, that being said, I'm like, I know I'm painting Dante. Dante's been around forever. He is kind of a Spider-Man of the 40K world. Everybody knows what Dante looks like. Dread the day they introduce Captain Ultra in MCP. Red, yellow, blue, green, black, orange, and orangey metallic gold. Paint Wolverine yellow and blue and do your best yellow and blue. Done. Yeah. You like not having to think about it. Yeah. Here are the colors you use. Do it.
Yep.
Go for it. And you can really focus on your technique, which works great.
Yeah.
Yeah, Shard, the canon scheme is so ingrained in me that I can't see anything else, and it strips in my thoughts. Like I said, it's all in my head. But in my head, it strips away my ability to be as creative as I want to be. I don't feel that way about Dante, because I throw the box away, and I don't care what the thing looks like. I know I want to do him in gold armor, because I'm doing all these blood angels, and I really want, you know, the leaders to be in the gold armor. And so it made sense. So it's just a part of the scheme. But I've chosen to paint blood angels, which are a known quantity. And I rarely ever do Marines, like, as an army. And here recently, we've done dark angels and blood angels. Now, the dark angels, I chose my own colors and didn't care. So I went total off-canon for the colors for my Heresy Dark Angels.
Aren't they black?
No, they're dark green.
I thought they were black for Horus Heresy.
They are black for Horus Heresy. Mine are not black. Mine are dark green.
Black to me.
No, that's green. It's very dark, desaturated green.
Very dark green.
Yeah, because I wanted to pull into the green. I didn't want to use just black. Punisher says, I want to get worried. I just want to get good at painting. I can worry about getting to be creative once you get there. And that's completely fair, and I understand that, right? There's times where you just want to have the ability to focus on your brush strokes and color be damned. And we teach that. That's why you'll hear me say that all the time. Don't worry about the color. Just paint. But when you take your personal rule of cool, right, that's where rule of cool doesn't apply for me. Like, well, I don't say it doesn't apply. I don't find cool in painting things with a canon color set is outlaid for you, or like outlined for you 100%, you know? Unless I can see it and I can say, ooh, I can do something really neat with that, you know? Like if I were going to paint all Imperial Fists, you know, oh, I could really paint a cool yellow scheme on all these guys, you know, and pull it off.
I think for me, too, there's a lot of, like, okay, cool, I'm going to paint these Imperial Fists. How do I make these unique, right? Where I kind of challenge myself to work within the lines.
Tim, my MODOK. I had fun painting MODOK because it's a big face.
I really enjoy how my MODOK came out as well. He's a fun model to paint. Painted two of them. I don't really want to paint anymore.
As a guitarist, you learn to play guitar by playing songs by bands you love. You approach learning to paint the same way. Exactly. And again, this is getting confused in conversation now. I'm talking about me. I've been painting for over 40 years, and I don't want to paint Spider-Man. End of story.
Yep.
Right? I don't want to paint Darth Vader. End of story. I just don't. It doesn't matter to me. Don't care. Doesn't mean you shouldn't, right? So never get that twisted, right? It's just in your journey, you'll find like stuff like that. Like when I learned to play guitar, I played other people's songs too. It's funny, I had to learn to play guitar under duress because a band that I worked with needed a guitar player because their guitar player up and quit and they were going on tour. So they needed a second guitar player. So I literally had a cassette and a cassette deck with a buddy of mine that was a great guitar player, and he taught me how to play these six songs that were on that cassette. And I learned those six songs. I had no idea how to play guitar, but I could play those six songs, and I went on tour, right? So that was my learning guitar. So I learned songs I had nothing to do with, nothing, and that's the way you played. And learning to paint can be very, very similar. Learn to paint this thing on this model the way you see it, and that's why box art, I think, is fantastic. Here are the colors you need to pull this scheme off. Here's the tutorial. Do it. Because what you'll do if you focus correctly is you'll learn the techniques needed to make that happen, and there will be a time in your painting journey where it'll click. It's not about the color I'm using. It's about how I'm putting the color on the model, and I could change this to any color I want and make it look this good. And that's where you'll start to open up and find your creativity in the models that you paint. And it doesn't mean that you won't always want to paint Spider-Man and the stuff on the box art. Jordan loves it. Jordan's a fantastic painter. That's great, right? But that's how you'll find your stride, is when color exits the main stage, let's call it, and it becomes brush technique an application of the paint that takes over your focus, that's when you start to know that, okay, now I've got this. Now this is becoming open-ended so that I can do anything I want to do.
I do think that it's very cool that you and I have total polar opposite opinions on this.
Oh, yeah.
Which is cool. I love it.
Punisher says, why do you hate Spider-Man? I don't hate Spider-Man. The thing is I love all these characters so much, I don't want to paint them. Right? You've got colors you love using. You've tried not to overuse them until now, but with your Seraphon, you're just going balls out using your favorites. Oh, yeah. Don't ever feel bad about there being a color you reach for every project. I mean, ta-da.
Yeah, seriously.
I've used more of this color than any human on the planet. It's on every model I paint, probably. I think I had to push myself to not include any dark purple on my Blood Angels because we replaced it with Payne's Gray, which for all intent and purpose is the same damn thing. It makes the same thing happen, right? But I think these are probably the only models I haven't used any dark purple on. And then I brought, you know, Dante into it. We used dark purple on the wing. So it's just it's a color that I use all the time. I don't have any regrets about it. People will be like, why is dark purple on every model you paint? Because I like dark purple. It's amazing, right? And don't ever feel bad about that, because there are colors that become, I don't know that I want to say they become part of your style, because I don't know that they're always visual. Like when you look at models that I paint directly, if you're not here on the stream and all, dark purple doesn't jump out on my models. It's not something where you say, oh, it's the dark purple guy.
Yeah.
But when you get in close and you start studying, you're like, oh, I really like how every single model in this case has got dark purple on it in the shadows, because it's such a pronounced shadow color. But the way I use it is very sedated. You don't feel it. But as a tool, it's a tool I use all the time. And so it does become part of my style without ever actually being visually noticeable, right? And it you know, some people call that a crutch. You lean too hard on dark purple. What if I took dark purple away from you? I use dark blue. You know, well, what if I took dark blue away from you? I use Payne's gray. What if you took Payne's gray away from me? I mean,
it's like, by the time
you go
there,
you can't just take all the dark colors away from me.
Yeah.
So, you know, but that's just kind of the way it is. And don't feel bad. You know, we run into that as artists in gaming, especially, because you might find yourself painting an army. Like, let's say I painted my Rebels for Star Wars Legion, and then I painted my Battletech miniatures, right? And I can guarantee you that they're very similar. Because when I think about military armies, I gravitate towards these kind of really faded camo schemes, like deserty camo or really faded green camo schemes, because I like that, you know? So if all I did was paint World War II infantry and mechs, I might be screwed because my case might look very, very similar across the board, right? But don't worry about it, you know? Unless what you're doing is trying to paint a bunch of models for somebody else that's paying you, like Jordan was alluding to before, I don't think it matters, you know? I do like to have some variation, you know, like when I'm, like right now, you know, like we talked about yesterday, we're painting a lot of non-metallic gold, right? So if we bust out the latest three models where we've been painting lots of non-metallic gold, four models, I guess, really, right? We've got there, and then here. Right? And the one thing you'll notice, they're all different, but they're all gold, right? Or yellow metallic, bronze, gold, whatever. But I'm able to do it to where even repetition in material and color can feel different. And so as an artist, once you start getting comfortable with what I was talking about before, which is thinking less about color and more about application and technique, then you start dragging color back into it. And then you can grab any color as your shadow because you know how to make shadows work. So as long as it's a dark color, you can make the shadow work. And then you get to start feeling more confident and playing around with, what would this shadow look like if it were dark red? What if I use mahogany as a shadow for this green? What would that look like? And so you try it because you know how to make shadows work. And so there's very rarely a time that you can, quote unquote, mess up. It may not be what you're looking for, right? You may not like the outcome, but it will work. And so then you can start saying, oh, I don't ever feel repetitious. You know, I'm going to paint dark green, or I'm going to paint camo green, and your camo green can be, but this time I'm going to use dark blue as the base as opposed to black, you know, black green. And all of a sudden the models look totally different, but they're still camo green. So I've said for years and years that I hope if there's one thing you take away from watching us paint is that there are so many ways to skin a cat. There's as many ways to paint as there are artists painting. And even within a single artist, like myself or Jordan, you'll see tons of different ways to do the same thing. Shard went into painting trying not to fall into many patterns, especially going dark and using heavy washes. You wanted to develop a more bright and bold style, kind of like Emma Svensson's work. Yeah, whatever intrigues you, I say go for. That kind of, don't feel like it's theft. If you're trying to repeat a technique that you see that you like, what will happen more times than not is it in the process of copying, if you want to call it, and I hate that word, but in the process of recreating something that you feel is really neat, you'll find your own style in that vein. So as you try to recreate something that's bright and vibrant, you'll find the way the brush moves in your own hand to achieve that brightness, right? And in doing so, you'll find something that, while maybe inspired by what you started liking, will become your own over time. Even if you just do a direct rip. Like, even if you do heavy, heavy cross-hatching and bright colors and stuff, you'll wind up at the end of the day with it being your own. And I think that's what's great about art, is that where it might start as, oh yeah, that looks exactly like so-and-so. As you get your stride, and as you hear things like that, you say, oh yeah, I do need to change that a little bit, right? Then you'll find the way to get to where you wanted to be in the first one. You have a few cats if you want to demonstrate to people how to skin them. I said, don't skin cats. Don't skin the cats. Punisher says, how many colors do I have to take away from you before you just say black? It's funny, right? I don't use a lot of black. I don't use a lot of white. White's our biggest selling paint because it's the greatest tint and usable white on the market, but we use it very rarely. I'll use it on the white chest piece and on the wings as my final highlight, but there won't be much of it there. You only use white for zenithal priming or for absolute highlights on yellow or white? Yeah. I mean, white is a great color to use. Like, if you're painting stormtroopers and you want to get them done quick, using, you know, a dark gray and then a white, almost like you were doing a zenithal highlight, and then washing that and then highlighting it back up is a great way to do that very quick. But you generally want to have a way to knock your white down via a wash or some form of a dirty filter, weathering of some sort. But, you know, you can still use white as a color on your model. You just are going to do that early and then put a filter over the top of it. You know, wash Nuln oil over it or Agrax Earthshade or something to darken it up. Use our brown wash and it'll give you a really, really good dirty white that almost becomes bone at that point, right? And then you can highlight the edges back up and it works.
Yeah. I actually like mixing, when I do that, I like mixing brown and black wash together.
Yep.
So you get something right. That's a little bit more of like a shade. And while still looks a little dirty,
yeah,
is more like standard use instead of like mud.
And you start to find your stride with color. And you'll come on to channels like this and you'll hear us say, oh, try this and this and this. And the goal is not to make it seem like that's what you have to do. The goal for us is to make it seem like that's the method to start thinking about achieving that color. Now go find your way. Come back and show us what you made.
Base coating all this gold. Almost done.
Somebody was asking about the metallics.
Yep, that was Source. Showing the rich gold right now.
On these parchment style pieces, I like to do all of my painting, as you're noticing probably, with a hatching across, linear across, because then I start getting my darkness looking like spots where there would be writing on there.
Yeah, Source, this is right out of the pot. And I have a two-stage wash process for the gold for this faction, which turns it from this into this nice kind of rich, detailed...
Yeah, I love that.
...gold.
It looks really good.
Yeah, it's flesh wash, basically right out of the pot, followed up with a thinned-down brown wash, and then dry brushed with the bright gold, which is the next stage up. Guy. And you get this really beautiful, rich gold. And it's super easy. It's literally two layers of wash and a dry brush and you're done. Which is a perfect strat for when I'm trying to paint something fast.
Yes. Washes are so incredible, and our washes especially, because you can also mix them with your paint colors, right? So you're not just stuck with a paint that operates so differently that if you filter it over the model, then you got to figure out how to come back and build a highlight into that. It just kind of works.
Sense of what this guy looks like all together. That's pretty cool. Yeah, no, this metallic is absolutely incredible. It just base coats like a dream. And let me see here. I can even show you some of the other ones real quick. Dark silver. Another beautiful color.
Bronze.
Bronze is really good too. So this is a dark silver right here.
Bronze is by far my favorite of our metallics.
Yeah, walking harder, I do.
Yeah, the medium is not meant for coverage. It's very translucent so that you can add color to it. It does work as a pretty good highlight for your silvers. It's a very bright platinum or polished aluminum color, the metallic medium. But it does not have a good amount of opacity to it. It's very limited in that regard. By design.
I'm actually going to paint this dark silver onto the area down here. Kind of get a good sense of how good the coverage is. We're painting it on. But look at how smooth that coverage is. It's incredible.
Yeah, he puts his metallics on wet palette too.
Yep, it works just fine. Helps him stop from drying out too much.
You found one guy reviewing your gold kit on YouTube, and he managed to get a very splodgy result for some reason. I'm just not using them right. Squidmar reviewed, he did the video about the best gold paint, and ours was technically the best gold paint. He gave number one to a pigment that wasn't a liquid paint. Had to make it into a paint. I don't count that. And it's been rated very, all of our metallics have been rated very highly by tons of people. Now, as with everything, paint is subjective. What do you like? What fits your style? So always take that with a grain of salt, but I am a firm believer that if somebody you respect their painting with gives it a thumbs up, that it probably has a good chance of being something you can learn with and get the job done. That's why we do this stream, right? We've been painting on this stream for coming up on 7 years. Showing you the paints live every day. No Hollywood magic, no tricks, no nothing.
We just want to show you guys all the cool things, how to do all the cool things.
Let you judge for yourself.
Yep.
Whether the paints look like they'd work for you. But we put them through every imaginable situation. You've had issues with them getting glittery. It's just spreading the pigment. Anytime your wet palette is too wet, it'll separate your paints, and that's what's happening to your metallics, if that's the truth. Because
yep.
The glitter, the flake, and the paint is a solid. It won't dissolve. It won't go away. Right? Solid material, mica. And so, yeah, you'll get stuck with the glitter floating kind of off on its own if you're not careful. Because your other paints don't have that component to them, they're just pigment. You may be finding that your other paints aren't giving you the same issue, so the palette's a good wet for part of what you do, but not for metallics. You can adjust as necessary. Some quick brown wash, then down with water on my brush. That'll help bring all of my streaky brush strokes together to then make all of that texture I was putting on these set up to be my writing, like I was talking about.
I know that this looks like it's a little rough around the edges for this edge work that I'm putting in here. And that's mostly because when I do the washes, it's going to clean all that up. And then I can go back in with a tighter brush and clean up all the edges and stuff that I need to reline with that.
Our washes are such a good cheat because of how they blend your brush strokes.
It's incredible, yeah.
You can paint so much quicker and in a much more loose fashion because they won't hurt you. They'll only help you make it look like you're a blending king. Same with the transparent paints. I use our transparent paints to smooth out textures. You can see what the transparent white did on the wings, smoothing out all my texture that I did on the feathers. It looked a little heavy-handed, and then I put the transparent white over it and smoothed it all out. I didn't have to go back and blend anything.
Yeah, those wings are looking great.
Right? It just takes the chonkiness out of the patches of color I put on there.
Any comment on mica versus real metal and metallic paints? I choose one or the other.
Well, you're only going to get mica or aluminum flake. And aluminum flake is only used in particular colors because you can't color it. Well, you can color it to some extent, but not much. So, you know, you can't get every color of metal by using a true metal flake. I mean, I guess you could. You could probably use something else, right? But aluminum's the only thing that won't tarnish over time in a water base. So you have aluminum and mica is your industry standard. And we use both. Why choose one or the other?
Rugged.
Only because of color. You know, mica can be colored so that you can wind up getting a different color metal flake that then you don't have to put as much pigment into because the flake itself is a bunch of the color.
Rugged Carton, how's it going?
Tim, take it easy,
Hello.
Man.
See you later, Tim.
And Rugged, what's happening?
Rugged, a first-time chatter in the Twitch chat. Welcome.
Charlie says, I've been using the transparent white a lot to correct mistakes while using speed paints and contrast paints, express paints. You can gradually take it close to where it was with the zenithal instead of full white. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. The whole idea when doing the transparent white is that it allows you to kind of cheat in your brightness where you want it without fully committing to white. And these wings are a fantastic example, right? The wings were all done in the dark purple, the jade, the magenta, the warm yellow, and the pale yellow. And then by taking the transparent white and putting on it, what it did is it just desaturated that whole palette into that you know, in that HSV color wheel that we use, which is hue, saturation, and value. It desaturates them while taking the value up, which starts moving things towards white, but we didn't use it as a blunt white. And I say blunt because if you were to just spray titanium white over all those colors, yeah, you could thin it down, but as it builds up, it just becomes white. It's super overpowering. It doesn't let a lot of those other colors show through, where even up here on our brightest highlight with the transparent white, we're still getting a feel of like that dark purple shadow. The jade is still showing through. The magenta we catch down here, right? The warm yellow, of course, is really fighting through in every layer. So even over here, because our light is coming from our right over on this side. And so even over here where I have the most brightness that I put on the wing, you still are getting the feel of all those other colors. And so transparent white is legit the white I use more than anything else when I'm looking for white paint. Because in very few cases am I looking to punch something to pure white, except for like those final highlights on non-metallic silver and such. I might punch just a small dot. Generally on gold, I use like pale yellow or bright ivory in place of white because it keeps me in a frame of more warm coloration that works well with golds. When I'm doing silvers, I don't have a problem pushing it to white. Rugged says, just painting some Tyranids while your ankle heals after breaking it on Sunday. Well, don't
no.
do that.
Oh, bummer.
Don't do that. So I'm gonna be really honest with you, Rugged. The whole pounding yourself in the ankle with a baseball bat while watching television. I know it's kind of one of those, it feels like an I told you so. But
it's an I told you
but
so.
But it's an I told you so. Hope you're healing okay. It sucks breaking, especially ankle, man. I would much rather break the flat part of a bone like mid femur or something. Probably not my femur.
Yeah, that would probably suck.
Ulna, radius, tibia. I don't like busting parts that are supposed to move. Busting the ones that don't move is okay. Would you use white on silver if you also had non-metallic metal gold on the same model? Sure. Yeah, do I have an example? I mean, this is close. This is white blue, I think, is the brightest that I've done here. Right? But it gives you the same feel. Like, I would take this to pure white in the brightest highlight on the bluish gunmetal, right? Even when I have gold, it only goes to ivory. Right? Even when they're right next to each other. I don't have a problem with that. It doesn't hurt anything. It might make your, depending on how you load it, it might make your steel appear brighter because white is the brightest color you're going to get, right? But I don't mind that. Yellow metallics are generally going to be a little bit duller looking than the same, you know, level of polish on steel. Not always the case, because you can polish gold till it looks like silver. Yeah, I don't have a problem with that. It works fine. We did the same thing here. His claws are a little removed from any of the intense gold, and that's really the only silver there is. So using a cool, bright color a la white or white blue on steel while using a warm, bright color like bright ivory or ivory on your gold works well together. It keeps the metals separated. It keeps things feeling right. This one might actually have... Yeah, this one's actually white and then ivory or pale yellow. So that's a good example right there. Oh, speaking of which, same exact wings. That's what we are doing here. I have painted these wings many times.
Dante did it best.
I don't know, man.
Wore them best.
I really, really think Yndrasta's wings are spectacular.
Yeah. I think Dante wears them better, though.
Oh, who wore it best?
Who wore it best? Dante.
That'd be a good photo. That's a good photo op.
Yeah.
Gotta learn how to tuck and roll. It was your own damn fault. You were helping a coworker move lumber and you decided it was a genius idea to jump off the truck while it was still moving in order to get the forklift ready to unload the truck.
That was bad idea.
I can kind of almost see, did it roll or did you flat foot it? Because it feels like you probably rolled your ankle at that point, right? That sucks. That sucks, Rugged. Snakes. Why did it have to be snakes?
Just a few snakes, not very many.
But yeah, silver and gold, don't ever worry about it. Do your thing. Non-metallic metal, going up to different levels of highlight works really well. Now, you can also play it where, I guess that's true. Same thing with the Wraith. Same, I just use white. I was going to say, you can also do, if you wanted to keep everything warmer... You can do your steel or silver non-metallic by doing things like what you see me do with like blue-black or Payne's gray and pale yellow and mix all your highlights up that way. You have to switch over to ivory at some point because the pale yellow and the blue, once it starts leaning on the scales more towards pale yellow, starts greening out your base if it's a bluish color like blue-black or Payne's gray. So there's only like a middle spot where you can add pale yellow to a darker color to get that steel feeling, or it starts turning into green because of the yellow, but you just stop and then you start adding in ivory at that point and you get the same pickup. And then you can also then use ivory on your gold so that your final highlight is the same on both. It won't make them look samey because one is in a different color range and blues and grays. And then the golds are in the yellows and whatever base color you use, green in the case of like Dante or, you know, whatever you've decided to go with, oranges, purples, blues, whatever. So you can do that. And the reverse is true, too. You can also take your golds up to pure white and do your silvers up to pure white if you want to have their shine be, you know, at the same level. That's just up to you. There's not a hard, fast rule as to which one you have to do. This is why women live longer than men. We not so smart, guys. So I like to think of it as, men, we just like to have fun. You know, they did the girls just want to have fun song. That was a lie. It's really the guys that want to have fun, which is also why women live longer. It's just our version of fun is a lot different. Some of us jump off trucks to see if we can get to the forklift quicker.
Sometimes.
While some of us stop the truck first. Like, here, hold my beer. Watch this. All right, gang. I got to cut out. Are you going to continue to paint?
Yeah, I think so.
All right. I'm going to leave you, Jordan. I have a 2:30 meeting. Okay. So I got to dodge out and get ready for that. But have a wonderful time with the rest of the stream, then. I will put you into...
Oh, no.
Well, I guess I won't. Why won't I?
We gotta futz around with this. What's up?
It's the same thing it was. I'm still punching it. It worked. It didn't work.
Hello.
I was the one not working. Chat, have a wonderful rest of your show. I gotta go have a meeting.
High five.
I will see you back mañana.
Way to go.
Hiya!
All right, chat. We're doing it. We're doing it, chat. Really, yeah, man. I'm really happy with how it's coming along. I am stoked. I am feeling it. Got a lot of stuff to paint in the next week or so. But, we're sitting at, let's see here, this whole thing, right, is pretty far along, and we are, what, 3 hours and 45 minutes in? Not so bad. Not so bad. We got this guy, sits on here, bada boom, and then this guy who sits next to him. Bada-bing. Like that. And that's it. That's all we got to do left. I got to do the base stuff too. Got to throw a wash on all this gold. I'm just getting the snakes sorted. We've got a riderless Pterodonna. From this box, Pterodon, bashing some skink chief bodies with Raptodon biter bits to make landers. Nice, that's cool. Man, I really love those Pterodons. Those models are sick. I haven't built mine yet, but they're really cool. They have interesting rules too. I'm not sure if I'm like gonna use them all the time, but they're very cool. All right, so let's do this wash on the gold. That can dry while we address some of the greenery on it here. Also put a little bit of that wash on here. Let's mix up some... I don't even think we need to mix it up. We just wash straight out of the pot for this. So this is my quick and dirty recipe for beautiful, rich, and interesting gold. I'll zoom all the way in on this so you guys can see it. But this is the final product that we're going for. Got nice detail to it. It's really rich and interesting. Nope. Slowfuse has got a meeting at 2:30. So he had to step out. And I'm going to stick around. We're going to paint for a little bit longer because I am having a freaking blast right now. So, you got me, Arctic Mini Painting Studio. You got me. Because I'm Chaos J. Ha, 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 ha. Also, if you have not noticed, my voice is doing significantly better today, which I'm stoked about. My body is recovering, and I love it. All right. We got, let me zoom out just a touch. All right, flesh wash going on. Boom. Bada boom, bada bang. Gonna give it that nice rich color. Yeah, glaze bending is, you know, it's not too bad. You just gotta trust the process and take it slow where you need to take it slow, and you can rush it where you can rush it. Because you can almost layer your glazes when you do blending like that. All right, let's look at what it looks like down here. Oh, yeah. Nice definition. Loving it. All about it, chat. Yeah, see how much this shine comes through? Now that it's got a little bit more definition and that warmth to it, looks super nice. And you'll notice with this application, I'm being pretty careful with it. I don't want to go too crazy. Don't want to spread it around where we don't want it. We're choosing a nice specific area to put it in. We're keeping it nice and controlled, not letting it pool too much. Unless we want it to pool in those areas. Like right here, I don't want it to pool there. Pull it away. We're going to use that moisture that I pulled up. We're going to put it on the back part here. Boom. Forgot to paint that gold. So we're gonna paint it gold real quick. Bang, bang, bang. Getting it done. Well, we're happy that you ended up okay, and it was just a broken ankle. You can recover just fine from that. Throwing all the wash in here. About it. Like it. In there. Bada boom, bada bang. Throwing the wash on here. Like I said, we're not thinning this down at all. This is right out of the pot. Want to get maximum stainage on the surface of this gold to warm it up. Get this one down here. Dry it up. Boom. Bang, bang, bang. Looking good. I'm all about it. I don't know if you can tell, chat, but I am, man, am I happy to not be coughing a bunch today. It has been a rough couple of weeks with this whole recovery from this stupid cold. Ugh. I hate being sick and having sick symptoms for like 2 weeks after getting sick sucks. I don't know how you guys feel about it, but let me tell you how I feel about it. It sucks. Not a fan at all. Yeah, look at how nice that is. Nice and dark. So when Shatterpoint comes out, what do you guys want me to what do you guys want me to start with? Any model in particular that you guys would like to see any cool techniques on? Because I'm going to paint them up real nice. They're going to be fancy schmancy models. Not going to be any of this like bang it out in 2 days sort of thing. We're going to spend a good amount of time on these models. I'm gonna let you guys pick. Boom. That is all the gold so far on this. Jess, is there a Bad Batch crew set? So there's a Bad Batch crew set that they're doing for Legion, I believe. I'm sure they will eventually do one for Shatterpoint as well. Right now, for Shatterpoint, they have... Well, what comes out first is Ahsoka and Anakin against Asajj Ventress and Darth Maul. And the Asajj Ventress and Darth Maul come with a couple of B1s, which are the burp, burp, catch them droid, right? And then the good guys come with clone troopers. From the Clone Wars. I think they're considered Phase 1s. That's the core box set. And then we get Dooku with some B2s. Or no, we get Dooku with the assassin droids. The ones with the lightning staffs. I think I forget what they're called. They're not assassin droids. There's something else. Yeah. That sounds correct, Wad Tomato. Magna Guards, that's what it is. Thank you so much, Rugged. And then we also get Obi-Wan with a unit of clones as well. Is the other release that happens on the day of. And then we got Grievous coming a month later, along with there's something else that comes out at the same time. I don't remember exactly what it is. I don't know why I'm painting the back of this thing, because nobody is going to see it. Can you even see it on this thing? You put them on this darn thing. Oh no, you can see it back there. Alright. Broke. We're gonna make his skin just like really ugly, dirty. Zoom in for this. Brown color. Because this guy is old as heck. He's an ancient, technically dead toad. You are correct, Songer. Not really alive. I mean, kinda, but like, not really. Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't mind doing Ahsoka first. That sounds like fun. Because there's also two Ahsokas. There's the young Ahsoka that you get as the promo, which I don't know if the store that I'm going to get it from has or not. I guess I can probably ask. Might be able to get my hands on one. It comes out later anyways, so I'm not super worried about it. Yeah, kind of live, but not really. Yeah, it's a... Broke's got a weird little bit of something-something going on. He's kept alive by the lizards. Or something. By the power of his magic. Magic space frog glitch. That is pretty accurate. Mandos and Wookiees are my faves from Legion. Bad Batch is going to be a must-buy. Absolutely. They're really, really cool. Stonewolf, you're right. I look and sound very different. It took the wonder drug and became much younger. I've traded some of my beauty for smartness. How are you doing today, Stonewolf? Double dog lost. Yeah, that's true. All right, we're going to give this guy the good old flesh wash. Might even throw it on the snakes too. Let me see what this looks like. Nope. That's a big old nope. We're gonna use a brown wash on that. Yeah, Rugged, this is Lord Croak. He is the ultimate Slan, undead Slan model for Seraphon, or Lizardmen. If you are a fan of old school fantasy. And he is a really old, maybe sort of dead, sort of not dead, frog mancer. He's very good at casting spells. And by very good at casting spells, I mean very, very good at casting spells. I think my goal is before we end stream today, we're far enough along that I can glue these both of these models onto the palanquin. That's the goal. Doesn't necessarily have to be completely done, but I think it at a minimum should be at that point. Because then I can spend tomorrow finishing up the last little bits and bobs on this fantastic model. And then I can finish up a Skink Star Priest, which will take all of, like, an hour, probably. Wash on here. Bang. Throw that on there. Not a care in the world. Good. Nice rich color on there. Alright. I don't know a ton either. I just recently started playing, but I got into Seraphon and I picked up the book and the army. So I'm enjoying messing around with that right now. Doing cool and fun stuff. Down some highlights on this guy so we can throw the wash on him. Being kind of rough about it, this guy doesn't have to be super fancy. Alright. Looking pretty good. Where that guy goes. And we can even glue him in right now. What the heck? Why not? Let's do it. Shave down some of this peg a little bit. Alright, where? Le glue. Here. All right. Looks good to me. All right. Need some leaves. On some additional color on these leaves so they don't look quite as contrasty glazed. You can also hit the little ones that we missed as well. Get them all from this side. Couple on the back here. just roughly stippling all of this green on there. Ooh, damn it. Just dipped your brush into your whiskey on accident. Sounds like a good day. Whiskey painting! You'll be fine, I promise. On the bright side, at least you know it's going to be sterile for the most part. Oh, dang. So it's got paint-flavored peanut butter whiskey now, huh? That's got to be very interesting. Cool little ferns underneath here. So how are you guys doing, chat? Have you guys been enjoying Wednesday so far? Anything fun planned for the weekend? I think we have our Battletech campaign starting up on Saturday, which will be really cool. Very excited for that. Thank you, Phil. Excuse me, new guy Phil. Little bits and bobs of green in here. Oh, look, there's a little toad. You little toad. You guys can't see him. Let me see if I can get him on camera. He's right there. You little toad. This little toad man. Alright, so you guys have seen, I've got most of the brush, the base coats done. Started to develop some of the other colors on here. Oh man, I missed a whole bunch of brown over here. Ralph's gonna go back and finish that up. Finish this green that we missed earlier as well. Yeah, a lot of this stage of the painting is just going back and cleaning up little itty bitty mistakes where you're like, oh, I forgot to do this here. Forgot to do that there. Need to paint this here. Not so bad. Okay. It's looking good. Have a little bit of this, a little bit of brown. Wad Tomato gonna play Marvel Champions in a bit here and board games on Friday and Saturday, friends. Maybe Battletech on Sunday, but probably not. Yeah, I get that. Sometimes when you have a really busy week, you just wanna chill at home. You're like, I have done entirely too much this week, and I deserve a day to just sit around and be doing nothing. I deserve it, darn it. I am deserving of this time away from people. I'm just giving a little bit of dry brush. This is bone color. Looking nice. The reason we want to dry brush these is so that we get this nice soft gradient. So that as we build up the color, it's going to look not super jarring as we build up this color. And I'm painting all the stuff that's kind of hard to see on stream. Cold rain. So what I do is I have the paint on my palette and then I dry it off on this piece of paper that I have here to get all the paint off, and then I just dry brush with that over it. That's how I get all the excess paint off. Gosu, what's up? How's it going? Yeah, you want to see the whole... the whole kit and caboodle. Get him on there. There he is. In all of his dead, undead glory. Yeah, it's looking real nice. The really complicated models. Lots of crazy stuff going on over here. Dead Jester, you wish you could paint like that? Well, it's really not that hard. It's a lot of just thinking about the process, starting step by step, I don't know if you were here yesterday or not, but if you want to watch the VOD from yesterday, it does the vast majority of this under, like, base coat painting. Anybody could do that. You may not have been able to think up the idea of how to do it yourself, but it is something that anybody could learn to do very quickly. So go ahead and check out that VOD from yesterday. It's the last hour and a half of stream where I start painting this model from start to finish. Or not start to finish, but where I started this model. And it'll give you a really good grasp of how to use all the transparent paints. Because most of what I did on this is all transparent paint. So definitely check it out. Because you definitely can paint like this. I'm not doing anything that's super crazy. It's just a lot of base coating. And using washes and dry brushes and glazes. Nothing super fancy, no fancy blending, no fancy anything. It's just picking the color, putting it on the model. And all the techniques are very straightforward. And if you do have questions, feel free to ask them while you're here, because I am more than happy to help you out. It's the whole point of doing this tutorial deal that I've been doing over the last couple of days. I really want to teach you guys how to do this stuff. Because I find it really fun, and I enjoy it a lot, and I wanted to impart this knowledge on you guys. So those of you who have been hanging out, I hope you enjoy it, or have been enjoying it. Dead Jester, let's get you the link to the Discord, because we have a really active Discord where you can post all of your photos, get feedback, or ask questions. I'm on there very frequently answering questions and chatting with people. We have like, I'm pretty sure over 2,500 members at this point. Yeah, Brulig just put the link into chat for you. So go ahead and get signed up for that. We'll get you in there. Tons of really amazing painters in the Discord. Super helpful. Very great people. Always more than willing to teach and impart knowledge. Yeah, Tim, I'm still here. Slow Fuse had to... excuse me. Jason had to step out for a meeting at 2:30. But I was really enjoying working on this, and I'm making really good progress. So I wanted to keep going. I might go for another 15, 20 minutes. I wanted to get to the point where I could glue this guy and this guy onto the model. So I gotta like throw a wash down on all this stuff. Finish painting the back of this guy to an extent that I'm content with. And then I can throw him on. So I'm pretty cool. Oh yeah, Solo. That's the whole point. I really wanted to talk to you guys and show you guys how to really make mince work of a model like this. Even as complicated and as crazy it is, you know, if you approach it the right way and you find really quick and easy ways of cutting corners and making the model look fancy without doing the hard work, you know, that's really what I wanted to teach you guys. Between yesterday's stream and today's stream. Cool, gonna go flip your turkey wings then. Nice. Yeah, this talking is definitely getting to me though, so I'm not sure I want to go on for too much longer. All the projection of my voice that's really killing my throat at this point. Yeah, that bone's coming along. Thank you, Solo. Going fully monochromatic on the throne and rings instead of trying to pick out the details. Yeah, you just like really just make it simple. A lot of this detail is all covered up anyways by the model, by Croak himself. So it's like, why the heck am I going to spend all the time painting all that stuff if it's just going to get covered up by a model anyways? There's no sense in doing it. So it's like decisions like that, right? You spend your time working on the things that are going to make the most improvements. So this is Lord Croak from Age of Sigmar, Seraphon. One of their big fancy character models. He's an old undead frog wizard. Very cool. Yeah, of course. Good. Snakes a little bit of a dry brush before this wash to bring up the value a touch. Dead Jester 12, thank you for the follow. Yeah, if you keep on hanging out, you keep on listening to the stream, ask plenty of questions, and we will get you to whatever level of painting you want to get to. We're big on helping people out and teaching people new things. We love to grow the community and to get you guys to paint whatever it is that you want to paint, get to wherever you want to be painting that. One of our favorite things to do here. I'll make a little mix for the next stage of this gold. Awesome, I'll take a look at it when I'm done with stream. Alright, we're going to make this black wash. Where is my black wash? We want to do brown wash. Not black wash, brown wash. We're going to dump a bunch in here. And then we're going to use the glaze and wash medium. Put a bunch in there. Then we're going to add a good amount of water. We're going to mix this all up. And the idea here is that glaze and wash medium is going to thin out that wash a bunch. We thinned it down a little too much. Gotta bring it back just a touch. There we go. Looking pretty good. Throw the wash on here. And this wash is going to go all over a ton of this stuff. Can you thin out wash with water? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, so Slayer Street. So I used a mix of our brown wash. So I would say 2 parts brown wash to 1 part glaze wash medium. And then add an additional 3 or 4 parts of water until you get the desired stain level of your wash. Right, so this is pretty thin, right? It's very transparent. Now you can make this more or less stainy by adding less water. Because it'll be heavier and it'll be a little less intense. Or less water will make it more intense, excuse me. That's what I meant to say. Run out the brown wash over a lot of this model. Get it over the bottom parts of these. Sorry, you guys can't see any of that. My bad. Hitting the bottom parts of these bones. Hitting the palanquin with it. Giving it a nice little bath. And this is kind of a little bit of what I would like to refer to as a unifying wash. So it's kind of getting everything to feel very samey, right? Dead Jester, I used both the glaze and wash medium and water. Yeah, add a little bit of water, or you can add the glaze and wash medium, which is truly amazing. It allows you to make this the wash a little bit more, a little bit less intense without making it too watery, which can be nice for a lot of different applications. You made the mistake on one of your models by putting the wash directly from the jar. You know, that can still be okay. This wash right here was directly from the pot onto the model. That's the first stage for all of my wash for the gold. I just used the flesh wash right out of the pot. I didn't thin it down at all. The reason why I want to thin down the brown wash is because I want it to get all the details recessed, but I don't want it to stain a bunch of this color, because I spent a lot of time creating this color, I want to keep it. So you can see, I'll just do the wash on him really quick, zoom in. You can see how this wash, when I throw it on here, just goes into the recesses. It doesn't stain the surface like it would if I just went over it with the regular wash. And this whole guy is gonna get this wash treatment. AntsForge, thank you for the raid. How's it going? Hope you had a good stream.
are wet in my pants.
Going good. We're having a great time so far. Finishing up Lord Croak. We got the vast majority of him done since yesterday. We did about an hour and a half on him yesterday. And got him from basically a Zenithal Prime to... dropping a model. Got him to right here. This is what we're looking at. So we got a huge amount of this model done. And we're just throwing on a bunch of washes to do a little bit of color filtering. To define some colors in the recesses. To finish up all the gold. Oh yeah, so like Brulik said, once this wash is dry, I'm gonna go back over it with a dry brush of our bright gold. And what that's gonna do is that's gonna bring back a lot of that color that we had from the original rich gold to brighten it all up and make it feel more gold again instead of this kind of like coppery color that we've got. Yeah, and you can use the original color, or you can come back with a darker color, or rather a brighter color, excuse me. All right, did I miss any spots? The gold? I don't think so. Maybe the inside of this one. Outside. Jester, you're good. We're all here to enjoy the time and figure stuff out. Yeah, doing this kind of unifying wash step is one of my favorite processes of doing this kind of painting. Because it's really where everything sort of just comes together and becomes fully realized. Yeah, T. Schmidt. Jordan is speed racer on these lizards. I am a big fan of painting fast. Yeah, we did this in basically 2 days and change, right? We did this on Monday and Tuesday. This is about 3 hours. We got the Bastildodon done. We got Croak bit just about done. Let's see here. What else do we need to do? Or what else have we done? We did the other Slayan in about the same amount of time we did Croak. We got a unit of stuff of the Raptor Riders. 2 units of the Raptor Riders done last week. So we're making pretty darn good progress on this army, you guys. I like to paint fast. I'm not joking when I say I like to blast armies. I love painting stuff fast. And the cool thing is, the more you do this kind of painting, where you paint stuff really fast like this, the better it looks. You get to the point where you're like, I'm just happy with this. And then when you want to focus on painting stuff for like competition level or really, really fancy stuff like the Morrigan, right? You can spend your time and you can really delve and spend, you know, 50 to 100 hours on a model instead of, you know, 5 or 6. So, yeah, it's awesome. It's one of my favorite things to do. Yeah, this is really coming along. I'm loving it. It's one of those things. It's really interesting. I really found my love for doing this kind of like crazy fast painting when I left doing studio painting full time, because I needed to start teaching myself how to paint, you know, other projects. And I didn't want to paint all my models to studio level because it takes for freaking ever. So I was like, okay, well, I got to teach myself how to paint fast then. Okay, well, what's the process for that? And I basically had to teach myself and learn lots of ways to do, you know, really fast painting very efficiently. And I have a little bit of this skink wash from yesterday or the day before. Let me use on this guy. Yeah, you paint faster by starting with red painted hands. You are correct. First thing I do in a day is I paint my hands red. Because they go faster that way. Also, hello, Mo. Good to see ya. I haven't seen you in chat today. So I figured I'd say hello. I don't know if you've just been lurking. And this is how we get a bold power red shortage. You are correct. Good to see you, Mo. Hope you're having a great day. Hope your cat is treating you well. Mo has a very cute cat. I don't know if y'all know this. I am jealous. Makes me want to get a cat. Right on. Very good. Well, good to see you. Thanks for chatting away. All right. We got the wash thrown down on that guy. Well, while some of this wash dries, we can paint the basic material on the base, and then I think we might just call it done there. Dead Jester, you know, I have doubts when painting all the time. But it's a question of, you know, I have the experience after having screwed up so many times where I can just roll with the punches a lot of the time. Where I go, hey, I'm just going to try this thing. And maybe it doesn't work. Oftentimes it doesn't work. I think I've repainted stuff a bunch. I mean, you go back and you watch some of the clips of me painting her. I repainted her skin like 5 times during the time that I painted her. So, it happens to me all the time. But you just gotta roll with it. And you gotta think about it this way. Every time you screw something up, you learn something. You learn what not to do. Or you learn what to do. So you just have to apply that to all of the future things that you work on. And then you'll mess up something else. And you'll learn something different. And that's the great part about painting. Is no matter how good you are, how much time you spend on it, There's always a little bit more that you can learn. And we learn by doing. So, never worry about messing things up, because it's part of the learning experience. It's like anything. If I were to learn how to shoot a bow and arrow, I would suck at it if I first started. I know how to do that, so I don't suck at it. But if I were to start from scratch, I would suck. But the more that I learned and the more I figured stuff out, you know, you learn, you get better. You make you make mistakes. And it's okay. Making mistakes is all right. You don't get in trouble for it. You're never going to be in trouble from me for it, that's for sure. I'm going to be like, cool, you messed up. What did we learn? That's it. And then I'll probably just be like, yeah, I did that the other day. Because I screw up all the time. In fact, I did it earlier. I was like, hey, I'm going to try putting the red flesh wash on these snakes. And I was like, nope. I did it, and I was like, this ain't gonna work. So, the only thing you gotta do is trust in yourself to put the effort in and to figure out what went wrong. And as long as you're trying to figure out what went wrong, even if you don't figure it out right away, that's all that matters. Kind of working this paste in here. You'll see I'm kind of building this over some of the plastic so that I can tie everything together. Because I just want this texture to all kind of meld, become one. So I'm just painting it up over the details here. It all just kind of feels like it's the same texture. All right, that's the base. Yeah. There's the basing done. Yeah, and just remember, Dead Jester, I've been painting since I was, like, 9. So I'm on, like, God, how old actually was I? I would say I started in 2003, maybe? 2002, 2003, perhaps? So I've been painting for going on 20 years. So, yeah. But the thing is, I've only been painting professionally for like 7. And that's really where my skill level increased, right? Because, you know, when you paint casually, if you're not focusing on trying to learn and be better and improve, your improvement is going to stay very level, right? Whereas when you're focusing on learning new things and you're trying to improve actively, this is true for anything that you're learning. Anything that you're learning, if you are dedicating your mind and you're focusing on trying to learn new things, you get like this real fast, and it gets exponential, right? I'm looking on this guy. Yeah, you can see how this is drying. See how it's kept a lot of that color, but it's got a lot of nice definition in the recesses. So we're going to leave this as is. I think we're going to shut the stream down there. My voice is struggling a little bit right now, you guys, so I think we're gonna call it there. Thank you so much for hanging out, everybody. I really, really appreciate it. You guys are awesome. I'm going to walk over to this side so I can do the final spiel of the day. And we are going to be hanging out for a raid. So we're going to be finding somebody to raid here in a minute. So stay tuned for that. First things first. If you're relatively new or you haven't been here yet, make sure to check out the store. We are Monument Hobbies. All the paints that we've been using today from ProAcryl, we sell on our website, which we just linked down before, or just a second ago. We make all of the paints in-house that you see here, and we show them off for you guys, so you can check them all out. We got the Discord. So we got a full Discord full of a bunch of amazing painters who are more than happy to help learn or teach you guys how to do stuff. So make sure you get in there and show all your whips of prods, check everything else out. It's a super great place to hang out. That I don't get notifications for anymore. What do you mean, Tim? But anyways, don't forget, we stream 5 days a week. Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, we stream from 12 to 2. I know we ran a little bit long today. Sometimes we do. On Tuesdays and Thursdays, we stream from 2 to 5. And this is all Pacific time, so if you guys want to check in for any of that, please feel free to tune in at that time. And, thank you so much, you guys. We are going to go find somebody to stream. I hope that y'all have a fantastic afternoon. So stay tuned.
Ah, talk of the devil. Good evening. Oh, do a stretch first. Oh, my back just cracked there. Oof. Hey, there you are. Good evening, Jason. How you doing, man? We were just talking about your paints and their absurd coverage. Ah, it's Jordan. Jason's been lazy. Ah. Oh. Who let that happen? Like, he's cracked the whip, man. How you doing, man? How was stream? What were you up to? Did I see you were painting... I want to say Croak. I saw a thumbnail the other evening. And it looked distinctly like Croak's high chair. But I was teaching, so I couldn't actually jump in. What were you working on? And for those coming in as well. Hello, sorry. Forgot to actually introduce myself. That would be helpful. So if you're new here, my name's Aaron, a UK-based mini painter. LTO Mike? I think that was right. I've almost certainly got it wrong, but I tried. Thank you for the follow, welcome in. But yeah, for those coming in, hello, my name's Aaron, UK-based mini painter. Currently working on Belisarius Call, which I've stupidly said I'll do all in non-metallics. Kev Thulu, yeah, that'll do. I think that's right. There's the rest of him. It's not really glued together. You get the idea. It's a ridiculous amount of non-metallics. And we've got a big fancy base as well. So he's going on this. That's the current whip. Prior to that, the other thing that you guys will have seen around the place is this fella. The big angry pink boy. Among other things. And Jet, thank you very much, man. Doing great. Teach folks how to paint complicated models real fast. Okay, alright. Okay. So, spent 5 hours, on Croak? So you're actually speed painting Croak? Oh, this is every part of that just makes me go, nope. No. Croak's a model that I have a love-hate with that model. I love Croak. Made that chair. I take one look at that chair and I'm like, no. So the idea of speed painting that fills me with dread. I am very intrigued. Shoot a photo later. I want to see this. I really want to see this. Like, I badly want to see this. Anyway, thank you very much, mate. Yeah, it's coming together. We're getting there. It's starting to look... Now that we've got a bit of a stick nearly finished, and the rest of it is looking much better now, we can start to see a finish line. So we're at the nice part of the mini where it starts to become fun again, because it's like, ah, oh, yeah, I can see where this is going to go. That's why I have the same